Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord be with you. We're glad you're here for worship on this, the fourth Sunday of the Easter season. It's good to have you all here for this service today. I did want to make one kind of big announcement to just make sure we're all clear about it. Today is the last day that we're actually gathering monies for the Lake Oconee scholarship with the Youth Alliance. And so, as many of y'all know, we've kind of shifted in the Youth Alliance. They have their own board of directors now, and so we have had an organizational shift with it, and we are seeking to have a scholarship, an LOCC scholarship, at the Youth Alliance. And so today is the last day that we're collecting monies. Of course, I'm sure if Monday or Tuesday, Linda, we can still, if Monday or Tuesday the check gets here, that is fine. But if you're on the internet watching us and haven't made the contribution, we'd appreciate you coming and making the contribution here. If for some reason you went ahead and sent it directly to the Youth Alliance, that's fine. I mean, they'd say, okay. But if you wanted it credited to the LOCC, you need to make contact with the Youth Alliance and let them know that you wanted it to be a part of this scholarship. So help us out. You know, just appreciate your generosity in that area, because it goes to good young people. If you've not had a chance to meet some of the young people that are going through this scholarship program, they really are outstanding. So really gives you hope for the future when you meet kids like that. So I hope that you can be a part of that. We do want to continue to be in prayer. COVID, we were just having a conversation before worship. The spikes that are occurring in India and Japan are disconcerting. I realize it's not the United States, and thank God, you know, the vaccines and stuff have been going through our country to where it looks like at least it's tempering a spike. It's kind of keeping a spike down, it looks like. And so very blessed that we've had that opportunity. Other places have not been as fortunate. India and Japan are two of those places at the moment. And so we want to definitely be in prayer for those dynamics and be in prayer for those who are suffering from COVID. In this country, it seems like more and more young people are the ones that are now in the hospital. So it has shifted from being an older adult disease to now a young adult that are ending up in the hospital. And then the long-term consequences we're still not aware of and still don't know what the long-term pieces are going to be. So strong prayer concerns for that. And so let's continue to pray in that way. It's good to have you here at worship today. To John, the 10th chapter, verses 11 through 18. I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. Listen as I read from the Word of God. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. When the hired hand sees the wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. That's because he isn't the shepherd. The sheep aren't really his. So the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. He's only a hired hand, and the sheep don't matter to him. I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I give up my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that don't belong to this sheep pen. I must lead them also. They will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock with one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me. I give up my life so that I can take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I give it up because I want to. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it up again. I received this commandment from my Father. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say thanks be to God. As we enter our time of prayer and meditation, I invite each of us to take a moment of silence, giving us a chance to reflect on our lives, to see where the concerns of our hearts are, to lay those before God, and then to hear God's still small voice speaking directly to each and every one of us. Then I'll lead us in a community prayer, and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let us bow. We've gathered once again, O God, in this place to come and to worship you. And today, Lord, as we look at this 10th chapter of John here in the lectionary reading for today, we're reminded that we are part of a sheep herd. And being part of the sheep herd, we have a shepherd who's watching after us. And so oftentimes the image of the shepherd in the scriptures remind us that we're being taken care of. So no matter what's happening in this world and things that make us very anxious and raise our anxiety levels, whatever may be going on personally in our own lives or as a society, whether in this country or in the world, the concerns that we see all around us, Lord, it can make us truly anxious. And we need to be reminded that we really do have a shepherd. We have a good shepherd, a shepherd who's willing to lay down his life for us. So, Lord, remind us today, if we come into this service today worried about all kinds of things, remind us about the shepherd who loves us and takes care of us. Wherever we may be leading, if we tend to go astray and to stray from the sheep herd, we do have that shepherd that comes and finds us. We're told that the shepherd will leave the 99 and come find the one who has gone out roaming and has lost their way. And so remind us, Lord, that if we're feeling like we don't know the way, we don't know what the future holds, we don't know what directions we need to take, we aren't sure which choices we need to choose, Lord, if we're feeling just the weight of all of that, remind us that there is one that is looking after us. And thank God we don't have to rely just on ourselves. So help us to be good sheep in the midst of the shepherding experience. May we listen for the shepherd's voice. May we follow the shepherd's voice. May we allow the shepherd to lead us into the paths and the directions that we need to go so that we're living this life in all its fullness and living it as you had intended us to do. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One of the marks of the 21st century so far, at least in these first 20 years, has been an increase in anxiety among people of all walks of life. Just take a look at what there is to be anxious about at the moment. Think about all we go through. We've had changed economic situations around the world and even here in America, both the good and the bad, and people suffering in varieties of ways. We have watched pressure be placed on industry and prices. We're now beginning to see prices of everyday essential items beginning to rise. All of a sudden, anxiety over inflation has begun once again. We watch and we pray, you know, as the market sometimes bounces back and forth and we're not sure how it all goes. But we're anxious. Before everything settles, we tend to be anxious. And for some of this, folks have dealt with insecurity of jobs. Those in retirement don't have to worry about that anymore, but there are a lot of people who are feeling anxious because of the insecurity of their jobs. They're waiting and anticipating the announcement of, you know, is the employment terminated? Are they continuing to be laid off? Are they going to be rehired? Is it being cut back? Will the company be liquidated? We're seeing that a lot in the Athens area. Job security. Security important. In past times, it was taken for granted. Oh, I would have this job for the next 30 years or so. But the possibility of no job and of retraining for another job, I mean, it's a cause of anxiety. An awful lot of people these days are going to have to be retrained for other jobs. And that's a source of anxiety. Oh, and the changes in moral values. And the fact that there's not a consistent guide these days in the way people should behave toward other people, it raises the anxiety. People do their own thing without any consideration of the consequences of the well-being of others. And what's the result? Well, the result is security systems in our homes and lines of vehicles picking up children after school, and the reluctance to travel on public transport at nighttime, and children no longer playing without supervision in the park. Most of us grew up without that supervision, didn't we? And yet we dare let children these days be without supervision in the park. Lockdowns, practice of lockdowns in schools, can you imagine? None of us had to go through that, but children today have to go through the lockdown just in preparation for the day when their lives are in danger. Anxiety. You bet. This younger generation has tremendous levels of anxiety, and you wonder why. The change in the level of security and safety on the world scene raises our anxiety levels as well. Just the increased awareness of terrorism. Whether it's domestic terrorism or terrorism from abroad, where we, you know, here in America, we have been isolated for so long from that kind of thing happening. We would see it in the Middle East, possibly in Europe and Africa and elsewhere, but all of a sudden it's here and it's a possibility here. Whatever happened there penetrated into our society for those who would seek to do harm and to do death. So being in fear of being at the wrong place at the wrong time and being the victim of an act of terrorism has been a source of anxiety. The fear of shootings in schools, you know, that happen elsewhere and then one day could be repeated here. And that possibility that it could be here that that would happen. All increased anxiety about our safety and about the safety of our children and our grandchildren. And then with the increase in world travel, we have seen how quickly disease can spread throughout the world. COVID-19, of course, has been this past year. In times past, bird flu, swine flu, Ebola, others. It increases the awareness of our vulnerability. And it increases our anxiety. The changes in our environment. Oh, I saw a video just this past week. The global warming. It causes folks to be anxious, especially our children to be anxious. They know. We know about the destruction of the ozone layer. Planetary warming, pollution of water and air. They hear about the possibility of sooner or later that our planet could be hit by a large meteor, like the one who wiped out the dinosaurs in years past. Or the possibility that our planet becomes so warm that life on Earth as we know it will become so, so different. And then what about the changes in relationships? It will bring anxiety in our lives. The falling out with a family member or a friend. Parents who separate and divorce. Aggressiveness of people in the workplace and on the roads and in the queues all raise our anxiety. And all this anxiety and stress is causing havoc. Havoc with our confidence. Havoc with our health. And havoc with our happiness. So let's get real. There seems to be little we can do about some of the threats that confront us in these times. We can, of course, try to minimize the risk. We don't walk alone at night. We don't resign from work without having another job lined up. We do pick up our children and grandchildren after school. We put locks on the windows and the doors. We make sure that the iron is turned off before leaving the house. We try to do our bit to reduce our impact on the environment. These things are rather like a little child trying to stop water coming out of the tap by putting their hand to cover it with. No matter how hard the child tries, the pressure is too great and inevitably, the inevitable happens. There was one church notice facing the passing crowd with this kind of advice. Cheer up, it may never happen. Okay, good sign, and that's true to a degree, but that kind of cheery bit of advice doesn't really help when it's your child who has the symptoms like COVID-19, or your grandchild is caught between feuding parents, or if you try to make the dollar stretch just a little bit further, it's not that funny. Surely, as followers of Christ, we would have more to say than just cheer up. And hopefully I do today. You see, a lot of anxiety is tied up with looking ahead and stressing over things that might happen. And there are times when anxiety grips our hearts and it fills with fear. And the future seems so uncertain. The future, it seems so threatening. For the Christian, there is an important ingredient involved with looking into an uncertain future, and it's called hope. Now, sometimes we think of hope as just wishful thinking, like saying, I hope that I'll come into a lot of money so that I can retire. That's a certain level of hope. But hope from the Christian point of view, hope from what we articulate from the Bible, it knows that even when bad things happen, God will be there with us, and with God's help, we'll be able to cope with whatever it is that is causing us, you and me, causing us to be anxious. Jesus said in our gospel reading today, I'm the good shepherd. Remember those words today. I'm the good shepherd. These words point to the God of the Old Testament who makes himself known to Moses as I am who I am. Jesus refers to himself as the shepherd in the same way that David refers to God as his shepherd in the 23rd Psalm, where he says what? The Lord is my shepherd. How many of us have put it to memory? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. And the real part there, even though I walk through the darkest of valleys, and oftentimes it's read at funerals, is the valley through the shadow of death, but it's really the valley of the shadow, the darkest valley, that he will be our God, he will protect us. That's the thrust of the 23rd Psalm. And our hope rests in the almighty and all-powerful God who took the tragedy of the cross and turned it into a victory. He overcame sin and death. He rose from the dead, and today is a living Lord who is our divine good shepherd. Hope says that you and I have nothing to be afraid of. Absolutely nothing to be afraid of. Nothing can cut us off from the everlasting love of our Savior. In the arms of Good Shepherd, you and I, we are safe and secure. We can relax. We can relax because whatever happens, even if death itself should come, there is nothing to be afraid of, because the good shepherd wants only good for us and will take us, you and me, will take us with him to the joy of everlasting life. The Bible's picture of a shepherd is nothing like the sheep farmers of today, kind of how we do. You know, today, vast flocks of sheep are across various paddocks and usually well away from the care of their owners. Oh, they might see the farmer entering in the paddock once a day, and at certain times of the year they come with fodder. But in the seasons when there's plenty of grass, in today's, you know, the sheep are just left to fend for themselves. Go out there and eat as much as you want. The grass is full, just go out there and do it. Oh, they come into the contact with the farmer when it's time for dipping or crutching or shearing. And they're treated with about as much individuality. They're treated with about as much individuality as a can of baked beans in the supermarket. But the old world shepherds, oh, it was a different story. They lived with and for their sheep. The Palestinian shepherd who wandered the hills in search of fresh pasture for his sheep only had a very small flock of sheep and knew each sheep individually. And in some places around the world, shepherds still watch over their sheep, leading them to grass and water. They know the sheep, and the sheep know their master, and they happily follow along behind them. The shepherd God of the Bible is not some distant figure, uninvolved in our daily lives, sharing both the good and the bad weather with us. One of the most meaningful pictures in Christian art, it shows Jesus, the good shepherd, leaning over a cliff with his arms reaching down to clutch and rescue a lamb which is caught in a thorn bush. The artist wants to get across the idea that Jesus is the one who cares, the one who saves the lost, who rescues from trouble. He is the only one who is intimately and individually concerned with each one of us. He knows each of us by name and knows exactly what is filling us with anxiety at this very moment. The image of the rescuing shepherd leads us to think of what would have happened to that lamb if the shepherd hadn't cared enough to rescue it, or if the sheep was wild and stubborn and refused to be helped. Because of his love for his sheep, the shepherd goes to any lengths to make sure that the sheep are safe. Even those times when you and I feel that life is out of control, things are happening that makes us anxious and afraid of the future, Jesus, the Good Shepherd, suffers with us and suffers for us. And even when our worst fears become reality, his presence assures us that nothing will happen to us that is outside of his control. There's always a purpose, and he will help us through it and bring victory out of defeat. Oh, that's why people like Corrie ten Boom, Maximilian Kolbe, Diedrich Bonhoeffer, individuals who suffered terribly in the hands of the Nazis, were defeated and humiliated, even killed. And yet they were able to rise above the despair. They rose above the hopelessness. And in the end, they were victorious. They didn't dwell on the negatives. They didn't dwell on the hopelessness of their situations. No, instead, They lived in hope. If you and I decide to dwell on all the negatives, to keep our mind and our soul simmering with all the gloominess possibilities, beware that our small anxieties will grow into big anxieties, and they will affect our health. They will affect our well-being. They will affect our relationships and our confidence. On the other hand, if you and I, if we choose to dwell in hope, focus on the promises of God in the Scriptures, rely on God's love for us, and trust the Good Shepherd who reaches out to us to hold us and rescue us and comfort us, instead of shuddering and cringing with anxiety over how things will turn out, always thinking of the grimmest possibilities, picture Jesus right here with us in the middle of what is causing us so much anxiety. That is what the 23rd Psalm does. The Lord is my shepherd, David says, and I have no reason to be afraid. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. They protect me. His goodness and his mercy and his love will always be with me till the day I leave this life and enter into eternity. We can be even more certain of this than the psalm writer was because we as Christians know of the love and the grace of our Savior, Jesus Christ. You can stake your life on the faithfulness of our loving shepherd. Nothing in the future is stronger than his love for us. No matter that at the first it may seem overwhelming, no calamity that engulfs us, no grief which is in its first dreadful impact make us wonder if we will ever smile again. For indeed, the Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. And in that we say thanks be to God. Amen.
Beautiful follow-up message in this hymn, which probably a lot of you have heard. It's a beautiful hymn for reflection and meditation. And the words say, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee.
Thank you, David. If you'll please stand. This is an opportunity of witness for a world that's quite anxious and all that life is giving. It's an opportunity for us as Christians, individually and collectively, to shine the confidence that the Christian faith gives us. And so together, we share that confidence as we go out living in this world this week. And we say the prayer of St. Francis, which truly encourages us to make a difference in this world. So let us say this together as we leave this place. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for joining us today here at the Community Church. Hope you'll join us in person if you live in the Lake Erie. Good to have you.